Lyon about the diagnosis and endoscopic treatment of ampullary cancer. Okay. Welcome.
Thank you very much. So it's more basic, you want to say, huh? More practical, in a sense.
More practical.
Yes, more practical is probably the best terminology. So I will mainly speak about, so thank you very much for your invitation, and it's my pleasure to present some technical aspects of medicine. And this is what we call ampullectomy. In fact, I will not speak too much about ampullary carcinoma itself, because it's not a really very interesting topic for us. It just consists to insert stent, so it has nothing too specific, and does not change too much with pancreatic cancer. I think it's more interesting to speak about ampullary adenomas, because then we have a real curative effect from the endoscopic treatment, and we can have a discussion with a surgeon. So first of all, the diagnosis, and then the treatment, of course. So I will be brief on the introduction. Just I will show you some data from the endoscopic series and from my series too. So concerning the incidence, in fact, we have of course a registry concerning ampullary adenocarcinoma. But as you know, they are usually registered together with cholangiocarcinoma and pancreatic carcinoma. So that we call usually peri-ampullary carcinoma. So they are not individualized. So this is the first point. But concerning ampullary adenomas, they are clearly not individualized. We have no data concerning the number of cases and incidents. Nevertheless, at least we observe some change. And in the past, at the level of ampulla of water, it has been described only cancer, carcinoma, and mainly from surgical series. And you see from the large series, the rate of adenomas was only 4%. And the more recent series are series from endoscopy. And in fact, this was the first series published, and I published this series in cancer, 32 patients, and you see the rate of adenomas was 35%, and with some intramucosal carcinoma, 15%. So totally, the rate was 50%. So this was the beginning of what we call the era of ampullary adenomas. So there is clearly a sequence, and the sequence is in fact the same as in the colon, probably faster if you consider the different endoscopic series. But I will concentrate more on symptoms and endoscopic patterns. The symptoms are quite, I don't want to say fascinating, but quite interesting. We don't have only one symptom. And even more, we have some pancreatitis. You see that in 30% of cases, in 15% of cases, the patients present with pancreatitis. Usually, these patients are considered to have acute biliary pancreatitis, and it is more difficult to make a diagnosis of ampullary adenomas in this case. Of course, the classical presentation is jaundice, because, of course, the lesion does obstruct the ampulla of water and does obstruct the common bile duct. At the lower part. So usually we have jaundice, but not always. And I think, I don't want to say more fascinating, but more interesting is the fact that in 30% of cases, patients are asymptomatic. And even in the last series, which is the only one prospective and which has been published by the French Society of Digestive Endoscopy in 2014, you see 34% of the patients were asymptomatic. And so, how they were detected, in fact, just, and we say by chance, when performing upper GI endoscopy, our colleagues observed a large ampulla and performed biopsies and finally confirmed the presence of ampullary adenomas. So that means probably there are more cases, because asymptomatic 35% of cases, so there are probably more cases. And for sure, the rule is when we perform an upper GI endoscopy to have a look on the ampulla, despite it's not so easy, because ampulla is, of course, localized laterally in the duodenum. And with forward viewing endoscope, we don't see so well this anatomical part. We don't see so well the ampulla. Nevertheless, we always teach our students to have a look on ampulla and to perform biopsy in case of large ampulla or suspicious of adenoma. Then there are different endoscopic patterns. It depends where is located the lesion and how it depends also on the evolution. Of course, basically, classically, the lesions were considered as ulcerated. And mainly they are, of course, at the stage of carcinoma. But they can only be exophytic at the level of a papilla. This is the ampulla, in fact. Huh? It's a transversal view of the ampulla, and the duodenum is here. And it's exophytic at the level of papilla. So this is the ampulla, and this is the papilla. And we can also have endoampullary development of a lesion, probably at the beginning. And the anatomically speaking, the lesion appears just like a prominent normal ampulla, because the surface looks normal. Some example of ulcerated with bleeding and exophytic, which is the classical pattern. But more problematic is this one. It's a large normal ampulla. Maybe the papilla is a little abnormal, but very, in fact, not so different from normal. And it looks like more or less an impacted stone. And the patient more or less present like with symptoms of impacted stone. That means, for example, pancreatitis. And it does represent 30% of cases initially in my series. And how to make the diagnosis in case of endoampullary tumor? We can perform EUS, but EUS is not so specific and can also have a false positive, because it can be only an inflamed ampulla following a migration of stones. So in this case, it is necessary to perform a papillotomy plus biopsy inside the ampulla. Nevertheless, we have some problems related to artifacts due to coagulation when we perform immediately biopsies on the sphincterotomy site. So that's why it is necessary to wait 2 weeks in order to avoid artifacts related to electrocoagulation. So, in fact, this patient presents with symptoms of common bile duct stone migration, or symptom of what we call sphincter of Oddi dysfunction. EOS is almost normal, or just observe an inflammation of the ampulla. And so in this case, we are in trouble. So that's why we really need to perform the papillotomy. And the more, I think the most stressful case is the case where the ampulla is also normal. And the patient has the papillary dysfunction symptoms. And in fact, you can only find this lesion when you perform biopsy. So that's why when we perform sphincterotomy for papillary dysfunction, we should always perform systematic ampullary biopsies 3-2 weeks later. And this is, we observe an ampullary adenoma in 4% of cases. So these are different, so I presented to you different endoscopic patterns. Also, I don't want to insist so much about the genetic factors, but just to emphasize the fact that we have sporadic adenoma and we have adenoma related to familial adenomatous polyposis. And in fact, in the different series, especially the last one, which is the more interesting because prospective, 24% at familial adenomatous polyposis. That means that in 75% of cases, these are sporadic cases. So we have two types of ampullary adenomas, and certainly the approach is different for the two types, not in terms of technique, but in terms of indications. In case of sporadic adenoma, we treat all sporadic adenoma. We don't wait for degenerescence. In case of adenoma, in familial adenomatous polyposis patients, we treat only patients with high-grade dysplasia or with large ampulla. And probably there is a role of bile mutagenicity to explain this location. So the endoscopic treatment. If I had a problem with the format of my video, but maybe at the end you will see, I will show you a video of an endoscopic treatment. Which are the indications? Ampullary adenomas without submucosal carcinoma. And this is, of course, very important because in this case, you have a risk of lymph node metastasis, especially at the level of hilum. And of course, without ductal involvement, because you can easily imagine that, endoscopically speaking, it's very difficult to treat a lesion which does invade the common bile duct or the main pancreatic duct. And this could explain some recurrence too. So no intrabiliary involvement and no parietal involvement. So that's why EUS is mandatory prior resection of ampullary adenomas. And by EUS, we look for the, we have a look on the submucosa, which appear, in fact, white. This is a white layer around the ampulla. And we try to find an invasion of this white layer. And in this case, when there is an invasion, there is a risk of 30% of lymph node metastasis. So this is definitely not a good indication for endoscopic treatment. And intraductal involvement is also very important. This is a series from 10 years ago, in fact, which clearly demonstrates that endoscopic resection was curative in 83% of cases without intraductal growth and 46% with intraductal growth. And there is certainly a risk of recurrence from the ducts. Not especially from the bile duct, because we can easily analyze the bile duct, but probably for the pancreatic duct, because invasion in the pancreatic duct is very, very difficult to assess. So this is a case, for example, of a large ampulloma, adenoma. And you see following resection, so a snare is in place. And following the resection, so this is the border of the resection, and you see this is the muscle from the duodenum. And then this is the biliary bile duct, in fact. And from the bile duct, you see a lesion, and this lesion suddenly falls down. And this lesion was, in fact, attached to the bile duct. And so, in this case, it's sometimes possible to snare this component, but in the larger majority of cases, endoscopic treatment is a failure. There are now some alternatives to destroy this lesion by radiofrequency, but some studies are pending, so we don't have a data concerning the treatment of this component, this endoluminal component by radiofrequency. So to rule out submucosal involvement or intraductal involvement, EUS first. Usually we use standard EUS, classical standard EUS, but there is some interesting data concerning intraductal EUS. So what is intraductal EUS? This is just a small probe with a rotative EUS probe. And this probe is inserted within the bile duct or pancreatic duct on a guide wire, like this. And we can, of course, analyze, and this is a comparative, these are two comparative pictures, we can analyze the common bile duct. This is standard EUS. So you see the invasion of the lower part of the bile duct. The bile duct is here, in fact. The probe is here. And you see the invasion. And here, you have the intraductal ultrasound, and you see we are with a probe inside the bile duct. This is the pancreatic duct, in fact, and you see some lesions around and attached to the wall of the bile duct. And so it's helpful to determine that there is a, for in case of small intraductal involvement, the IDUS is very interesting. Of course, we can also determine if the lesion is limited to the mucosa or does invade the submucosa. So in this case, you see this white layer is the submucosa. Here, you have an invasion just localized here of the white layer. And this was demonstrated by IDUS, intraductal ultrasound. So in this case, it was a T1 submucosal carcinoma. Now, resection. So of course, I recommend to use EUS to assess and to determine the level of invasion, but then we have to proceed to resection. Resection is quite simple. This is not a very difficult procedure, in fact. The problem with ampullectomy is the morbidity. Resection is quite simple. We just apply a snare, usually on this location. That means it's on a retrograde way. And using a duodenoscope, we will see where the snare is localized or located around the lesion. Then, following a resection, you have the bile duct and the pancreatic duct and the bile duct largely open. And you see on the specimen, you have a pancreatic duct, a bile duct. And following resection, some months later, you see the results. Of course, no more ampulla. The surface is totally flat, and you see the two aperture. So it looks quite simple. Nevertheless, first step is to be able to withdraw the specimen as soon as possible, because we are in the duodenum, and sometimes the specimen can go further, can go further in the D3 or jejunum. So as fast as possible, we need to remove and withdraw the specimen. So these are the data concerning L0 resection from the literature. And this probably is more interesting. Of course, this is not because it's a French study, but this is the only one prospective multicenter study. And you see the resection L0 was quite good, in fact. And if I come back, just I forgot to tell you, for my colleagues who perform, for example, mucosal resection, and we inject, in fact, when you treat an ampullary adenoma, you never inject, because this is a sphincter, this is a muscle. If you inject, it does not help. So we never inject, except if there are some invasion lateral to the ampulla. So you see that L0 reduction is highly variable, but nevertheless, in this prospective study, quite interesting. And in the large series, quite high. The problem is the morbidity. And this is a more dangerous procedure we have in endoscopy. It's more risky than endoscopic submucosal dissection. It's more risky than mucosectomy. It's more risky than ERCP. This is a more risky procedure with a higher rate of morbidity. So that's why we should limit the performance of this technique, which looks simple, to, dedicated centers. So morbidity runs from 8 but to 42%. In this prospective study, 42%. And the recurrence is quite high too, you see, 24%, and Napoleon herself, only 5%, but quite high in large in some studies. So we cannot neglect the recurrence with sometimes the need to go to surgery, and I will come back later on this point. Now, if I come back to the morbidity, you see the morbidity is mainly related to pancreatitis, 20% in the prospective study, bleeding, 10%, perforation, 4%. So it's a risky procedure, and frequently we have bleeding, we have to stop during the procedure, and sometimes, unfortunately, we have perforation, which are then more difficult to treat at the level of a duodenum. So this is the prospective study I already talked about. So 110 procedures, acute pancreatitis, 20%, severe 4, and one patient died. So this is the only patient reported, only death reported in the literature, but this series prospective. One patient, so it means 1%, severe acute pancreatitis, bleeding, 10%, and which required transfusion or endoscopic hemostatic procedure. But I'm speaking about delayed bleeding, not immediate bleeding, because we have frequently immediate bleeding. And finally, cholangitis, probably due to the stenosis of the orifice. So how to prevent acute pancreatitis? Of course, now we use non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drug, but we also are obliged to insert a stent. The evidence behind inserting a stent is not so high, but now we all insert a stent, and we insert a stent, a small stent, in the pancreatic orifice, and we let the stent in place for 2 weeks. And there is only one randomized study. So if you are an oncologist, of course, one randomized study with only 19 patients is nothing. But this is the only one we have. So they compare stent versus no stent, and the rate of pancreatitis is what was lower when we did not use a stent. Sometimes it's difficult to find the pancreatic duct following ampullectomy. So what has been recommended to inject methylene blue prior papillectomy or inserting a guide wire and performing a snaring around the guide wire. But more recently, also stenting has been demonstrated to be effective to prevent acute pancreatitis. So in the guidelines now, it is recommended to insert a stent for at least 2 weeks. Then perforation. In four cases, the perforation was treated by just by medical treatment. And surgery was necessary in case of cholecystitis, for example, or pseudocysts related to acute pancreatitis. And at a delayed stage, we can observe papillary stenosis. But these are, in fact, not so frequent. Also interesting is the issues related to pathology. Because the diagnosis of ampullary adenoma is not so easy and needs a large experience of a pathologist. And they need to be used to analyze an ampulla of that. Because, of course, it's a combination of bile duct tissue, pancreatic duct tissue, and duodenal tissue. So sometimes, of course, we frequently a papillary pattern. So it's very difficult to, sometimes difficult to make a diagnosis of ampullary adenomas. So finally, we perform ampullectomy, but in 14% of 14 cases, this was not an adenoma. And so, for example, endocrine tumor, adenoma mitosis, myomatosis, hyperplasia, inflammation. So it was a multicenter study. In my unit, we never perform ampullectomy without first performing again biopsies of the ampullary lesion, because we want to, of course, to avoid to perform such procedure with high morbidity when, of course, it is not necessary. So my main recommendation is to perform again, to take care, and to perform again biopsy, and to ask a second reading by an experienced pathologist. Then the patients had a follow-up. And so also this is interesting. I will not speak about patients with familial adenomatous polyposis. I will speak about sporadic adenoma. And patients with sporadic adenoma, in fact, first of all, we observed that we had some recurrence, but with long-term success in our initial series, 92%. And this patient had Whipple. But in fact, more important is this prospective study. 36 months of follow-up, and you see initially, in fact, we have incomplete resection or submucosal invasion. We have ampullectomy in 99% of cases. And you see the follow-up of a patient. Late follow 5, and I will explain why. Unrelated death with recurrence 8 patients. Success, 37. Late follow. This is important. We had recurrence at month 7, month 12, month 24, 2 recurrence, and finally at 3 years. With adenocarcinoma in 3 cases, high-grade dysplasia in 1 cases, low-grade dysplasia in 1 cases. So, 5 recurrence. One patient had Whipple resection, one patient was treated by high-grade plasma coagulation, and 3 patients were not treated because we were not finally considered non-operable. So it means that the recurrence can be very, very delayed. So we need to follow the patient for a long period of time. And last point is the fact that we can have associated colonic adenoma, and the relative risk is more or less threefold, so colonoscopy is recommended. So I will not speak about this, but I think it's better to skip FAP, if you want. I just want to come to the summary and then to present the video. So the incidence of ampullary carcinoma is tenfold less than for colorectal carcinoma. In fact, it's not frequent disease, but nevertheless, with a high risk of carcinoma inside the adenoma. Ampullary adenoma is a recent concept. It could represent 50% of cases. There is a sequence, maybe stronger than for colorectal cancer. 30% of ampullary adenomas are asymptomatic and detected during an upper GI endoscopy. 30% are endoampullary. 30% are observed in adenomatous polyposis patient. And patients with sporadic adenoma should have a colonoscopy. And concerning the treatment, endoscopic therapy is the first intent. But nevertheless, we need first a second reading, prior resection of biopsies. We need to stage with UES, and the follow-up should be very strict, and at least 4 or 5 years. First at 6 months, and then every year for 5 years. So maybe if I can have a video. So this is a large ampullary adenoma. So the lesion is quite obvious in this case, because you see the duodenum, and the lesion is really exophytic. And I told you that I never inject. But in fact, we inject this part, because this part is not exactly the ampulla. The ampulla is here. So we inject the lower part of the lesion. And then we apply the snare. So by a retrogon way, usually it's possible to resect in one piece, like this. Following resection, you see the resection site. So immediately we remove a specimen. And then this is the resection site. So this is the muscular layer of the duodenum. And these are the pancreatic duct and here above the bile duct. So we insert a stent in the pancreatic duct. So resection looks nice in this case. Then we perform some coagulation of vessels or minor bleeding, but you will see that it will bleed. It frequently bleeds, in fact, and so that's why you always have to be ready to stop bleeding by clips or by just electrocoagulation, like in this case. In fact, it's very difficult to use clips in such case, because the endoscope we use is a duodenoscope with a lateral viewing and with a lateral channel, and so it's very difficult to pass the clips. We prefer to use coagulation. And you will see afterwards the results some months later. So you see the two apertures, and we always use indigo carmine to be sure that there is no remnant adenoma. Thank you very much.